Here to get our jersey retirement ceremony presented by Phoenix Garden are some other Memphis mentors, Al Capone and the Gary Griffin. Get your heels in the air for Marcazar. certain things for so long together, long that we created. It's a lifetime. Like, I know 20 years from now, I can see 90 TA is will pull you right back to that bond.
Was retired, and it was an emotional night in Los Angeles. How's Big Fella's emotions going to be tonight? I don't know, you have to ask him, but obviously it's an incredible moment to live and experience, right? To receive this type of honor is something truly special. So I'm so proud of you. Man, thank you. Proud of you, honored. It's incredible.
How you guys were growing up playing basketball against each other. First of all, how many years did you dominate? And then when did you find out that little brother couldn't push him around anymore?
Well, early on, he was, I had my way, let's say, but Mark, resilience, work ethic, determination, everything, his heart, toughness, competitiveness, everything. He caught up pretty quickly and he became one of the best players in the world. You know, I think even before he was drafted, like I said, at that time I was adamant, I was persistent to the Grizzlies management at the time to try to get him. They got him eventually, and everything worked out in a very, very special way. So, as you guys see here, he was impactful from the first day. He made a difference from the first day to the very end. He left an incredible and deep legacy in the city, so just proud of
him. When we talk about playing against Mark, you got that opportunity as a member of the Grizzlies when he was in Barcelona, and then of course when he came to the NBA. When I ask you about just playing against him, what's the first thing that comes to mind?
Well, I always say that it was very special to be able to play against your brother at the highest level. Very, very special. Never took it for granted. But I also knew that it was going to be a hard night, because I think probably Mark is the opponent that I had the least points scored in my career, because he knew all my moves, he was going to bring it. He didn't care too much if the point guard would go by or get an easy shot, but he made sure that I didn't get an easy look at all. So we always had so many good battles, we were going to bring it, and we had a good run.
Who talks more trash?
No, we don't talk. We've never talked trash. We knew one was going to be a little happier than the other at the end of the game because neither of us like losing. But we understood how lucky we've been and our family, the way they brought us up, and the opportunities they've given us, and the love that we received and continue to receive was pretty special.
You started the All-Star game.
Yes.
How much does that moment stick out
in your career? It's one of the highlights of our lives, I think. Especially, definitely of our careers, because that was pretty special to be able to start an All-Star game at John Ball and Madison Square Garden. That's kind of one of those iconic places, an iconic memory that is part of our legacy.
It's great to have you here. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Robert. Thank you.
Guys here that you may know, but Mark, I want to talk to you first a little bit. We can't talk about Marc Gasol without talking about the Gasol family, how much they mean to you, how much they meant to this community here in Memphis. How impactful was it to have them near you as you started your professional journey here in Memphis and really your high school journey in Los Angeles?
Hello everyone, and thank you for staying.
Your family is very important to your success. Surrounding you, how they care about you, how they take care of you every day, no matter what. Having my parents giving up so much of the social life early on in our lives for a happiness. You see it later on in your own journey when you become a dad, you understand, what your goal is in life. So, I'll forever be thankful to my parents, Christine and Marissa, for setting the foundation of who we are as men and the values that we have. So, yeah, family, obviously, is a whole world to us. You said to me, the Palace retirement ceremony, that you and your family are the best of us.
your humanity, and how you treat other people, and the impact you have in Memphis is phenomenal. Now, you saw Powell and have his jersey retired in Los Angeles, and you were an observer. Now the roles are reversed. How different is it to see 33 go up in the rafters as opposed to 16 in Los Angeles?
Well, it's a celebration of both of them at the same time. In the same family, I like, you know, we had our own journey. I had a journey, and he had to face his own challenges. I had my own journey, and obviously did what I had to do to, you know, to try to maximize my career. And at the end, it's great to see, you know, the celebration of everybody. And I like to celebrate Pop's career, my career, and share with everybody that's meant so much to us along the way. So I can't compare it. I know everybody likes to compare Pop and Mark, but to me, that's way, way past. Now it's about what's the next challenge going to be now as human beings. What are we going to impact? What life are we going to, you know, impact as humans? So I'm thrilled for that.
So often we refer to you as Marc Gasol of Memphis. You came here as an adolescent. You went to high school, and eventually this is where you started your NBA journey. Was there a point where you said, man, this really is my second home?
Well, I had a very unique perspective because I came as a 16-year-old. My family at Los Angeles, my teammates, you know, took me in. So I had a perspective from the fan point of view, you know, what is expected of the team here in Memphis. And I did that for 2 years here, and then, you know, obviously followed the team when I went back to Spain. So I had a very good perspective. And when I came back as a Grizzlies player in 2008, I carried that with me. And I played with that kind of pride. And I hope that everybody enjoyed, you know, what they saw for so many years.
The work that you have done with Powell through the Gasol Foundation, addressing childhood obesity, obviously your support of St. Jude and Lebanon Children's Hospital. Why has that been such a driving force for you in your life?
Well, that was our way to contribute. My parents, they both come from the medical world. We were not doctors, even though Powell tried for a year to become a doctor. So that was a very way to contribute. When we understood the impact that we could have in a kid's very tough process that they go through, their families what they go through, and kind of give more impact also with St. Jude and LeBonner hospitals like that, you know, try to accomplish. So for us, it's an honor, it's humbling when we do that, and actually, you know, they give us more energy than we can ever give them. So it's great, thank you for that.
It's great to have you here, Marc, along with your family. This date, once I knew when it was circled on the calendar. And then kind of the icing on the top of the cake is to have all of you guys together. So as the kids say, we're just gonna chop it up, right? We're gonna talk about the good old days. But I'm just curious, in talking with all of you, you come from different socioeconomic backgrounds, different geographic backgrounds, and yet you came together as a unit to provide some of the greatest basketball the city has ever seen. My question is a pretty simple one. How did that happen?
Well, I think how it gelled so well, we all respected each other coming in. Respect was the biggest thing, you know. We all came from a background where we had, you know, pretty much prove ourselves and had a chip on our shoulders. So when you got four guys that's coming to prove something, I mean, other teams need to watch out. The same way Tony said, this, you know, we are. I think for all of us, we are blue collar players. We humble, you know, Marc humble, like we are humble and we hungry. So you know, we're not no the fashion type. So you know, it's a blue collar town. So we a bunch of blue collar players.
I was the young man. I'm old as hell now, but I'm a young man in the group, and I just listen to them guys, man, just having such great leadership from you know, guys I look up to, and all the guys behind us too that are part of these teams. Rudy Gay, Mike Miller,
Mark, why did it all come together so well?
It was a combination of a lot of things, but the trust and the loyalty that we had in one another, alongside, like Max said, of, you know, our teammates and our coaches, and how much we invested in the team and in the city. I think then we saw, you know, we could trust each other, we care about the same things, and we all had the same common goal. So, you know, at the end of the day, you know, we were a great team.
Zeebo, we always refer to you and Mark as brothers from another mother. How did that chemistry kind of come together? Because, you know, Mark was a second-round draft pick. You were a high draft pick in Portland, and you had gone to other teams. But then you guys just developed this chemistry between the two of you. How did that happen?
I just think because, you know, Mark is such an unselfish player. He's just trying to, the type of person he is. You know, he wants to see everybody win. That's the thing about Mark. He'd rather everybody do good before himself. You know, he wanted to get other guys shots. So just us having that fun and understanding where we come from. And, you know, we're going to go out there and dominate. And we're going to kick everybody's ass in front of us. We thought we were going to kick some people. We were always ready.
And we don't bluff.
At all.
Look that tree!
Mike, you were the conductor of this group. Did you ever find it difficult to kind of keep everybody under control and keep everybody on the same path?
Yeah. y'all have no idea what it's like to be around these guys. Especially that dude right there.
I mean, no civil.
He ain't never changed though, but.
Yeah. Man, first team all defense.
Second team all defense, two in the field.
Oh, by the way, defensive player of the year over here.
We all in the building. But one thing though, Mike, I used to always want to ask, because both of these guys dominated their ball in the post. What was your thought process both of these guys wanted? That's the question I always want to ask. Because Mark wanted the fair set just as much as he.
Nah, see, I probably defer to Mark more because, listen to this. Because Zeebo, whenever he wanted the ball, he'd be like, hey, kill it. I need a shot. He'd be like, he ain't making no scene about it. Mark would be like, man, he'd start, you know, looking at me funny and then
speaking in Spanish.
Yeah, speaking in Spanish. You know.
That's all.
You don't know what he's saying. Like, I'm like, man, let me get Mark on so that, you know, I can get him first and Zeebo be cool.
Because there was a period of time, Rev and I would say, if the ball doesn't get into Mark's hands at some point, there's something wrong here. But by the same time, we also said, feed 50. So it was kind of, you know, one or the other. But yeah, you probably had the hardest job of anybody trying to keep everybody happy. And then, if he was unhappy, you guys sat next to each other on the plane.
Yeah. I was, like I said, I was a young one, man, and they picked on me. They I was one that had to learn the ropes. Like I just did what they told me to do. I tried to help as much as I can. Cause we're like the opposite of personality a little bit. Like I'm real calm. I'm more calm than all these guys. But like this guy
right
here.
Yeah, we noticed.
This guy right here, he's a problem. He gets angry. So.
You mean you never ripped your jersey down the front?
No, I never did. I never kicked trash cans over. He'll kick a trash can over after a 20-point win because we didn't do something. We didn't pass the ball.
Yeah, I remember. I seem to remember this game in Brooklyn where Jaren Jackson Jr. had a great game, and we ended up winning the game in overtime. Like, there's a 4-point play and another 3-pointer and win the game. And you weren't terribly happy after that game.
You didn't play good. always about playing good, play the right way, play together. And if we didn't do that, but we won, I wasn't happy.
Mm-hmm.
I was not always right, let's put it that way.
So I got to ask you a question, because we looked at the videos during the game, and I want to poll the group here. What's the best Marc Gasol celebration? Is it the Conor McGregor walk? Is it, feel free to vote. Is it the Conor McGregor walk? Is it the slapping of the hip? Or is it the air guitar?
Air guitar!
Air guitar!
Any votes?
I think the swag came out with the Conor McGregor walk.
Yeah.
Okay, put a little flame in it, and you know, he was happy. I mean, Mike passed him the ball enough that day, so. I go with Conor McGregor.
So the Conor McGregor walk, is it unanimous, or?
Yeah, Conor McGregor. You like it, Mike?
No, I'm embarrassed.
I think that was probably the one I was most surprised to see. And it was perfect because it was a timeout. You know, and obviously game-winning shot, so I think, you know, got a little bit more airtime, but.
Why did you do that?
We watched the fight a couple days before, right? And obviously he was so confident, he pulled it out. And so, you know, a few days later when I had a chance, we won the game against the Clippers on the road.
Mm-hmm.
Mike finally passed me the ball. hit the shot and we won and came out. It wasn't fair. It almost happened at three before that. I'm like, no, give me one more three. I got one more three. Okay.
Save it for a game winner, right? Not just, no ordinary three. Yeah, gonna save it for a game winner. This building saw some amazing playoff games and playoff battles.
Thank you.
I want to hear from each of you a memory from those playoff runs. What stood out about this building and a playoff run in Memphis, unlike any other city? Hope that clip. We don't bluff. I mean, Z-Bo, you got a corner of the market there.
We don't bluff, baby. Whoop that tree. Everybody get caught. Everybody go crazy, you know what I mean? So everybody just was in one, you know? We was all one, you know what I mean? We all won, and, you know, when we went to the playoffs for show, you know, everybody was all together, and, you know, we felt it. You know, we felt the energy, we felt everything. So we was with them, and we always won, so.
Yeah. What about UTA? Those playoff runs, those long battles with the Clippers in Oklahoma City and San Antonio?
Yeah, and it was all memorable. I mean, I can remember a lot of times, big fella, you know, speaking in Spanish to me as well, you know. I took one of those ill-advanced threes. And he would always tell me, you know, you get your money on a defensive end. Pass that ball. So, I mean, all of them was memorable. Like I said, the bond, but most sticks out, you know, we had, like I said on the elevator earlier, we always had that one team, one goal mindset, bombing through the playoffs. So, like I said, it carried over even till today. So,
it's all love. I like that one. All love. Mark, what do you remember about those playoff battles? San Antonio, I know that you referenced in the documentary about the very first playoff win in franchise history, Shane Battier hitting that shot. But there were so many memories and so many great battles with Tim Duncan and Kawhi Leonard and others.
Yeah, I think winning that first playoff game for the franchise was huge for the confidence of ourselves and that we could do this against probably the best team in the West, and also for the city to believe, you know, and come together at the same time support the team the way they did for so many years after that. So I think that first win in San Antonio, I would have it. And that was I think, a turning point for everybody. And you know, I thank Lionel also, because Lionel is here tonight. And that made me think of those memories. So you know, Lionel did a great job of bringing us together and executing and making sure that we all, you know, stayed in our place most of the time.
Right. Because it's all important to play the right way. And I don't say that lightly. I mean, that was one of the things that I admired most about you was your insistence on playing the right way, despite what Tony wanted to do. I said, that's one of the things I admired about you. You wanted to play the right way, no matter what Tony wanted to do.
Tony's going to do Tony like he always does. Just know, you got to be prepared for anything. But you know, you know how hard he's going to play. How hard he's going to prepare for the games and his matchup, and exactly what he's going to do on that end. So that gave me all the trust in the world on Tony. So I'm always thankful to play a guy, play alongside his family. Mike, what about you in those playoff memories in this building, in this environment?
I think I'll second what Mark said about that first series against the Spurs. It was a time in our lives, I think it was like the whole city of Memphis and Grizzlies were all like one team. We kind of embodied what the city was at that time. Hard-working guys, 1-15, our coach was, Lionel was on us every day.
No kidding.
I don't know if you can coach like that today, man. These kids go crazy, but it was a special time, special moments here. The crowd was what got us through a lot of it, gave us some special memories.
Well, you all gave us a lot of special moments in this building. Ladies and gentlemen, it's been a while, but it's been worth it. The Core Four.
It started everything that we all know. Grit and grind.
That's who we are. That's what we play for. Grit and grind. Scratch and swallow and fight.
Our minister of defense.
Whatever had to be done, he would do.
The backbone of grit and grind.
We want to be one of the best defensive players to ever play the game.
He was able to anticipate. He was super physical. His great hands.
Timing on those things. Stripping the basketball was like almost impeccable.
Sweat. Hard. Really deep. Just.
One time I remember I had it, and he swept so hard that the ball hit me, fell out of my hands, went back up into my hands, and hit it again. I'm like, bro.
One of the best defenders I've ever had to face.
He's a man. Man with incredible strength. Now you put him next to the power forward right now. Those two guys, people worry for him.
And artist with the ball.
One of the most skilled big men I've ever seen. Pass.
Plays the right way every single possession. It's all about the team.
He had the amazing ability to diagnose whatever his team needed at a point in time, whether it was needed more rebounding, needed more playmaking, needed more shooting.
Here's Gasol from outside, going to the three.
That just seems
like
Gasol
did
a
kind of
regular.
He ripped out his pride of heart.
Mark Gasol's legacy is not just on the basketball court, it's all. Everybody knew it, Gasol's in the family. Did
played for the city of Memphis, the city of St. Jude.
No, really?
Are you serious? My guy, oh my God.
I miss you so much.
I miss you too, buddy.
The guy who cares for his total integrity. The guy who's very nurturing and family oriented. That's how I know Mark. I've known him like that since we were 16.
He was sort of transplanted into Memphis and then accepted as a Memphis.
He was their guy. No one ever said he was from Spain. Everyone said he was from Memphis.
If you go back and look at his story, it's just an underdog story from the 80s, you know? And that's why it was so impactful for him to be a Memphis. The city.
For that period of time, he was the heart of Memphis. The nature of his game matches the character of our city, which is he'll roll up his sleeve and he's never gonna move.
To me, it's a small town in Memphis that made it happen.
We do love this franchise. I do love it. I'm very proud of the Memphis Grizzlies.
Number 33. He showed us you don't have to be from Memphis to be of Memphis. Number 33. Never to be worn again. Number 33 forever. Number 33. Aww.
It was all our privilege and pleasure to watch you play basketball at the highest level. It was also our pleasure and our privilege to enjoy your class, your grace, and all that you meant to this great city. Marc Gasol, first of all, congratulations on retirement of number 33. Not only to the Thunderbolt Raptors, but the Gasol name goes to the Raptors. Marc Gasol, the floor is yours.
This morning I got a chance to watch a wonderful documentary about myself. I was a little shy, I didn't want to watch it. Great job, Michael Revin. And I have two things after I watch that. One is, I got to start working out. That's the first thing. I'm like, okay, big fella, you got to start, you got to start moving. And second is, I got to apologize to my teammates, my coaches. I'm sorry sometimes, I don't have to be a pain in the ass. I just care so much about this city and about winning and playing the right way. So thank you. Thank you for putting up with me. The last week we've been here with my family and enjoying the city, driving around and spending time together, seeing a lot of familiar faces, seeing a lot of old friends. And the love and unwavering respect that we got from the fans and everybody in the city will forever stay with us. So thank you for that. That will,
Thank you!
We got here in 2001, and your constant support and love, I think it goes with everybody. So thank you so much for that. Seriously. Back when I was 19 years old, I used to play a game like I'm sure many of the kids still do today. I used to imagine I was Michael Jordan with the fadeaway. I imagined I was Larry Bird with a three, or Magic Johnson with a no-look pass. 25 years later, I kind of played the same game after I got traded from the Grizzlies to the Raptors. I imagine how would Tony Allen approach this defensive assignment that he has tonight against the best player in the other team? What would his mindset be? When they let it be, or they asked me to, I thought, okay, how is he going to take over, this stretch of the game and be a beast on the block? And through it all, I thought, how is Mike Conley going to keep it all together in a championship run? So when I was able to, you know, accomplish the biggest goal as a basketball player, which is to win an NBA ring, you know, these three guys that meant so much to me along the way, you know, were right there with me at the court.
Wishing you safe travels, and as always, go free.